HarperCollins presents The Hard Road Out, One Woman's Escape from North Korea by Park Jihyun and Seh-lynn. Translated by Sarah Baldwin. Read by Rosa Escoda. To my husband and children, and to the brave citizens of North Korea, Park Jihyun. To Soojin and Jimin, for the humanity and light they have in them. To Charles, who believed in me when I did not. Seh-lynn. Prologue. Jihyun's story could be my own. She is my age, speaks my language, loves kimchi, and is Korean. She fled to China to escape a dictatorship and protect her family before seeking asylum in Britain some 10 years ago. I came to London around the same time when my husband's job brought us here, and I've been here ever since. I haven't swum across the Tumen River or faced down the Gobi Desert like Jihyun has, but I have crossed many borders in my time. And each time, like a tortoise with its shell, I have carried my home. That is my Korean identity, with me from one country to the next. Jihyun is from the north and I am from the south, but we share a single identity. We are both Korean, and that is what saves us. Jihyun speaks of her childhood, her family, prison camps, slavery, and escape. I write of my need to connect two lives, to create a link, to repair. Who would she and I have become had our country not been divided? Writing brings us together. As Jihyun tells me about her life in North Korea, I take on her perspective. I access her inner world. I become her. Our experiences are not the same, but childhood, death, suffering, and dreams, these we share. Jihyun and I meet for the first time in 2014 in Manchester during the filming of a documentary by Amnesty International. An interpreter friend of mine has to back out at the last minute and asks me to stand in for her. The job is to interview Jihyun in Korean and transcribe her answers in English for the short film The Other Interview, which is scheduled to come out soon. I am nervous, not only because I'm not a professional interpreter, but also because the idea of speaking to a North Korean makes me uneasy. Isn't that risky? Am I allowed to engage with a North Korean citizen? What if somebody reports me to the embassy of South Korea in London for spying? I am still mulling over these questions as I fill out the paperwork for Amnesty International. Driven by some unnamed feeling, I accept the job. In the car carrying the Amnesty team from London to Manchester, the director brings me up to speed on the project, but the movie in my head is an entirely different one. I picture my childhood bedroom in our apartment in Seoul. On the wall is a poster showing a fist against a bright red background, with the words, "Down with Communists" in big letters above it. The poster won me second prize in the anti-communism poster competition organised by my primary school. It's signed and dated, Seh-lynn, 1976. I hear the shrill sound of the sirens that signal on the 15th of every month the start of the simulated attack, a practice established in 1953 at the end of the Korean War. During the simulation, life stops. No more cars in the streets, no more children in the schoolyards. People in their homes hurriedly descend to the bomb shelter in the basement of their apartment building. Seoul becomes a ghost town. Then, 20 minutes later, life begins again as though nothing has happened. And the 15th of the following month, the same sirens and helicopters, the same deserted streets. It's a routine, like any other. As the child of a diplomat, I was keenly aware of the presence of that other Korea. When we lived in Africa, for instance, when I was 12, there were three or four South Korean families in the city where we lived, all there on diplomatic posts. And there were probably as many, if not fewer, North Korean families. They were hard to spot, except for the occasional glimpse in the supermarket, because they rarely came out of their homes. When they did, it was always in a group. It was the first time in my life I'd seen North Koreans, but despite our proximity, the boundaries separating us remained absolute. Under no circumstances were we to talk to them. I was to hold tight to my mother's arm and stay close to the shopping cart lest I be kidnapped. When our cars passed in the street, I would scowl at them. They scared me, but at least I felt safe behind the glass where they couldn't get me. These encounters never lasted more than a few seconds, but those seconds marked me. I had been raised to believe all North Koreans were the enemy, and here we were, suddenly face to face. Other than that, though, being Korean in Africa was brilliant. With my slanted eyes and straight black hair, some people thought I was a cousin of Bruce Lee or Jackie Chan, while others saw me as representing the country of economic miracle, South Korea. At home, the Korean flag was always flying. I dreamed of becoming my country's president. Most of my foreign friends didn't know the difference between North and South Korea, and in some ways, that was fine with me. It meant I didn't have to explain that the North was communist and the South capitalist, especially since I didn't understand how that had come about and found it all very complicated. I was simply Korean, but in my mind, being Korean meant being South Korean. In my Korea, there were no North Koreans. In 1979, the year I turned 14, my parents announced that President Park Chung-hee had been assassinated by a North Korean spy. My mother wept. I felt sad without really knowing why. It was the beginning of my historical awareness. The interview gets underway. It's the first time I've ever found myself face to face with a North Korean. Roughly my age, her face is very peaceful, and like me, she's wearing glasses. She looks normal, not evil. But I am terrified. What if she calls me a capitalist pig, or worse? What if I am the one who says something terrible? My years of being raised to distrust North Koreans have left me with ingrained beliefs that I haven't ever really questioned. It is a good thing the cameraman from Amnesty interrupts the interview to adjust the microphone on her blouse and the position of her chair. Jihyun is polite and smiles, but she does not give me a good eye contact. Little by little, her story grabs me. My initial fear turns to shock, especially when she rolls up the bottom of her black pants and shows me the scar on her leg from her time in prison camp. My eyes fill with tears, my vision blurs, but I catch every word, every emotion, every subtle shade of meaning and tone. At the end of the interview, I'm exhausted, but strangely satisfied, even relieved. I have won a battle against my own beliefs about North Koreans, managed to favour the human over the political. I have just met one of those who never get talked about in political circles, one of those who reveal the history of a human soul and generally get omitted by the big picture of history. It's a small gift that has come to me out of nowhere. My path crosses Jihyun's several more times at human rights conferences in London. And even if we are always very happy to see each other again, we remain somewhat restrained. We keep it professional. Our meetings alter my perspective on the fate of our divided country, at least intellectually. We have, each in our own way, from either side of the border, she to the north and I to the south, been simulating war for almost 50 years. I have been her enemy and she has been mine. We were the good guys and they were the bad guys, and vice versa. What a coup on the part of the world powers, turning us against each other. We have become our own enemies. One question leads to another. I can't stop wondering, where have 5,000 years of shared history gone? My point of view continues to develop over the 2 years that follow the interview in Manchester, until it becomes urgent for me to face this question of fundamental identity. Was 2 years also needed for trust to grow between Jihyun and me? Jihyun had been mentioning that she wanted to leave a testimony for her children, until one day she asks me if I would write her story. Me? Didn't she already have a Canadian writer in mind? She wants it to be written by a Korean, without the go-between of a translator who can articulate emotions she can't express in any other language. She wants to use words that will bring her truth to life without eliciting either judgment or misunderstandings lost in translation. She wants to touch people's souls, yours and mine. She wants to tell the story of an ordinary North Korean family and the extraordinary suffering they underwent. With me. Reaching this point, both of us wishing to share our stories, has been anything but easy. And I accept. I want to give voice to history's invisible people, a people torn apart, a people no one talks about. I want to be among those who begin to talk, those who seek to leave behind the suffering brought on by a painful and tragic disunion that has been in place since the end of the Second World War. When I speak about Jihyun, people around me are interested. I want to tell the story of her battle to save the lives of other human beings, as well as the story of the Korean Peninsula shrouded in amnesia. 40 years of Japanese occupation, followed by a fratricidal conflict, the so-called Korean War, and a state of denial over the separation of the country ever since. Whatever it takes, we must lift the veil that covers up this chaotic past. We must tell it like it is. We must write this book. We hope it will be an initial step towards undoing 70 years of forced isolation on both sides of the border. Yes, Jihyun lived under a communist regime and I in a democracy. Yes, she was forced to leave her country and cannot return, while I left mine voluntarily and can go back when I choose. But the threat of war looms over the peninsula more than ever, and we no longer have time to focus on the differences that separate us. This is Jihyun's story, but it is mine as well. I ignored the monster from the north for as long as I could, keeping it at bay until I couldn't hide from it anymore. It became too big, too familiar, or too unfamiliar. Korea is about more than Gangnam style in the south and nuclear tests in the north. Between these cliches lives a whole world of ordinary people like us. It took me some time to accept that North Korea was part of my country. I'd been afraid of it for so long. But recent events have left me no choice. Don't spit on your own face, as the Korean proverb goes. North Korean, South Korean, we are all, first and foremost, Koreans. This book might have been written in two voices, but in the end, both eyes became the voice of a single restored identity. This is one story of one Korea. Seh-lynn, London, 2022. Chapter 1. Mummy, why did you abandon me? One afternoon in 2012, sitting beside me on a bench in a Manchester park, Chul asks me the question. I search for an answer but can't find one. Where to begin? What does he remember? Chul was very young when I left him in China to save him from going to prison in North Korea. But I did go back to get him a year later, and since then I have obtained asylum for him in England. Today, here we are, safe and sound, and happy. We are happy, aren't we? While these questions swirl in my head like leaves in a gale, the word abandon sparks fear inside me. My heart races, and flooded with guilt. I realize that this question has just breached a world I've created out of things unsaid, a world whose apparent calm was merely a facade, a precarious world in which I'd overcome the pain of the past by covering it up. My heart aches at the thought that Chul hasn't dared to ask this question since 2004, the moment of our separation. My eyes fill with tears. To think that he has endured 8 years of silence, 8 years during which he has preferred to keep everything to himself, crushes me with pain. I can't keep covering up the past. I must tell my son why I can't simply say, "I didn't abandon you." I must tell him why I can't find the words, why no sound will come from my throat. I must tell him my story. The distant past comes back to me like a murky dream, a lost world that collapsed before my eyes, swallowing up the people and places that had been most dear to me. The place I will never go back to again is Cheongjin, a city in North Hamgyong province on the east coast of North Korea. Cheongjin is a rectangular city built on a plain, on one side nestling up against the base of a rocky mountain range, and on the other, looking out over the water that separates Korea from Japan. Koreans call this body of water Dongye, or East Sea, while to the Japanese, it is the Sea of Japan. Being near the sea made summer's heat bearable, but the winters, when temperatures generally fell below zero.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.